an introduction of Keith here.
But I, you know, I think we all know. I don't think I can add anything to it.
Yeah, go ahead.
He's been in and around the Air Force for years. He's well known as an aviation artist. I'm going to just turn it over to Keith. I'm not going to say any more. He introduced himself. We all know. If anybody doesn't know Keith, I do have a brief bio.
I got a question for you.
You got it. It's all yours.
Well, I have spent my entire life with the Air Force, so and should have been in it, but I've probably flown more airplanes because of not being in the Air Force than if I had been in. And as I mentioned when we first started here, I've been able to fly with the Air Force from 1960 on with the Society of Illustrators Air Force Art Program. And since I knew that I spoke Air Force and knew how it operated, I was able to generate 300 hours of jet fighter time, deployed as a backseater as a civilian to Southeast Asia with the first squadron of F-40s. And I've flown almost every fighter in the inventory up through the F-16, the F-15, and so it's been a terrific career. And the advantage of all of that is that I was flying and working with the airplanes that my clients were all building, the engine manufacturers, the airframe manufacturers, avionics. So all of that stuff I was involved with flying, and so I was able to put it to work with in my painting. And I've been involved with Pratt & Whitney since my first national ad campaign was that scribble across the bottom in 1963. And up at the top, I grew up with the Boeing P-12s at Cali back in the early 30s, and all Pratt engines. That's my dad flying the lead on the left-hand side and flying the closer airplane over there in 1932. So I've been involved with Pratt & Whitney all my life. Little did I know I'd be doing paintings for them. I've done three paintings on the F-35 program. This was the Air Force one, which I did about 4 or 5 years ago. And that's the Eagle Range at up a hill at Air Force Base. Off in the distance, you see the Great Salt Lake, and Hill sits on the far side, looking towards the east. And you can see some of the markings on the ground for the gunnery ranges. And so that's the Air Force one. And then a couple years later, I did the Marine one, the V model, F-35, and that field there is about 1,800 feet long, and they were able to, of course, land that airplane vertically. So you can see one of them in the hover down there near the ground. And the object of this was to show a air base operation with the Marines that could land. No, this is actually Red Beach at Camp Pendleton. Right, I-5 is about 100 yards out of the picture, towards the bottom of the picture, passing through there. If you can imagine, they bring that airplane in over I-5. It's got almost a 50,000-pound thrust engine on it, which they point down. So they must stop traffic doing that. But you can see the landing airfield commander in a Jeep, or actually it is a Jeep, and then you can see them Army coming up to the Army area, and you can also see that B-22 parked on that little helicopter there.
So the time came to do the Navy bird, the F-35C, and when they came to see me, two of them did, sit and talk about this. And I went back in my collection and found this 1967 painting I did for Chandler Evans. And this is an A7, which is made by Vaught. But anyway, the idea was that we use something like this. If we brought, the idea was to get some excitement by being close to the water and leaving the ship. And so it was basically a pretty good idea. And we thought we'd work with an F-35C in this. But they actually wanted the airplane to come off of the number of the starboard forward catapult, and that forced me to the other side of the air of the ship. And so there's a napkin at lunch. The light looks like a cartoon character with a smile on his face. But it's just leaving the ship, but we have to show enough of the ship so that you can see the number on it, which would be 78. So that means moving around a little bit further. And so the next sketch would allow 78 okay. But then I needed the airplane. It has such a wide fuselage. The fuselage on an F-35 is roughly one-third of the wingspan of the airplane. So it's like one-third wing, one-third fuselage, one-third the other wing. But I still needed to see more of the far intake. I did it, being an aero engineering student at A&M, I learned a bit of descriptive geometry in that. And so I did a preliminary geometry plot to come up with that view, and that's pretty much what we're going to be dealing with. And I had all the drawings so I could build the airplane. You can see this airplane, those are all the structural frames and ribs and so forth. And I use a top view in this case and a side view. I'm going to be positioning the viewer out about 55 feet in front of the airplane. And you'll see how that's done here. There's all the cross sections of the airplane with all of its stealth characteristics. The angles on it are all designed so that it would reflect radar back in a different direction from the radar transmitter. So this is a typical plot here, and you can see down at the bottom, I don't know whether this has got it, yeah, you can see right here, this would be the top view of you if you were standing there looking at the airplane. And over here, you're about whatever it was, 10 feet or so to the left of the center line. And here we're, I can't remember the numbers, about 13 feet below the eye level, below the horizontal reference plane. So I can just very quickly line of sight to one item that you want, which is the nose. And you see it in the top view. Now we're going to go over here and find it in your eye level. Then we come up 90 degrees to the line that you're looking at. Then we come over and find it in this line again. And then drop straight down. And here's our horizon, so you can measure up from here this distance, and that tells where that nose is going to be. So I can do that for any point I want on the airplane. And I start out at the wingtips in space, so I'll be plotting 1, 2, 3, 4 points, and I'll have the wing. And the same thing with horizontal stabilizers, or running this point at the top here for the tails and so forth.
So you just don't wing it?
I don't wing it. Not for this.
I can pick up a brush and paint it.
And then very often I have to do this twice because I started off viewing position too low, and you can see the effect was it brought this nose gear right up next to the bottom of the airplane. And I thought, no, that's not going to work. I'm going to have to move up a little bit higher. And so there's the correct view, and done with the same way. So it's 10 feet and 13.5 feet in an airplane.
So can I ask a quick question?
Yeah.
So how long does it take, like, to do this drawing here?
I can do one of those in about a day, maybe a little less than a day, yeah.
How long would it take you, Bill?
Lifetime.
But this is because I've got to be exactly correct when I get it end up. So, and I'll start at the back of the airplane doing those cross sections that you were talking about and work my way forward until I get to the cockpit and so forth. Here we've got the flaps down already, and these are the flap, are the degrees for the flaps. In other words, each one of those will move that flap up at a different angle. So there's a 30 degrees of flap or 20 and so forth. Okay. So then the correct plot enlarged. I got the landing gear clear of the fuselage now. And we'll be able to see that pilot very clearly. We've got enough of the intake over here so that we're seeing. This is actually the fuel tank in there. This bulge has two purposes. One of them is to hide the face of the engine in, for stealth. The air intake goes sharply towards the center inside, and radar going off of the compressor blades will bounce back out, and will not, they can't get back out of that behind those bulges on there. So there's the refined structure. You can see how those bulges, the air goes around those and then back in behind to the engine. Then we've got all the...
What are they drawn on? A vellum or something, or just in the computer?
No, it's drawn on tracing paper. This is actually only about 3 or 4 inches wide wingspan. So I'll blow it up, enlarge it like this on the copy machine. And then over the top of that, I'll lay tracing paper and refine the drawing, get the leading edge flaps down and all of that. And so you can see how I was building the airplane. And of course, the further around to the side, the further we got around, I was going to end up having to do the whole ship. That meant learning the entire operation of how they were going to be operating the airplane. And the timing and all of that came into it, which you'll see why here. And the first plot I did a plot of the ship done from the top view and the side view of the ship from 200 feet, thinking that would be great. The only problem was that meant that the ship was almost as big or bigger than the airplane. So obviously I'm going to have to back away from the ship in order to make it. So if I had done a sketch, which would be this, and figured out that this is the wingspan in the sketch and this is how wide the ship is going to be, then I'd know that visual angle out there, the ship has to fit in that, and the airplane has to fit in this visual angle. So that would be, here's the ship, and now I've got to deal with, this is the angle of the airplane, that's how big it's going to be. But now the ship is going to fit in this blue triangle. So we've got, this is the geometry of the whole painting now. If had I been at 200 feet, I'd be dealing with that position on the airplane, and you can see why the ship would be so much bigger. More to it than meets the eye, huh?
Yeah.
So there's the too large in the composition, and there's corrected, and look how much difference that makes. Mm-hmm. All the way you can feel the thing coming right out of the picture at you. Mm-hmm. Yes?
How did you get a visual
picture? Did you see a picture? I did exactly the same. The question was, how did I do the ship, get a picture of the ship like that? What I did with that was exactly the same thing. I set up the ship like this and did my drawing of the ship in here from that position in the side view so I can plot, like, for example, if I want to go from this point here that's this point in this view. So I'll draw a line to that point, then come off the picture plane down here, and then when I look at it from this way, I find that point in the side view. Then I know I'm that much below eye level with the ship, so I can draw the... So as I start to draw, I find that point, and there's the horizon, that's my eye level, so I'm going to be measuring this distance down from that eye level to that point in space. So I can do all four corners of that, and that draws that ship exactly the way it would look from that many feet away. So that corrected it. Then the drawing, then I take the whole thing, which is only about 6 inches wide, and I blow it up to 56 inches, which is almost the size of that screen right there. And then I draw very detailed all the different things, like that landing gear and all that position. And then I've got all those airplanes and people and everything to draw on the deck as well. The ship, did I get the drawing from
the picture of the ship?
That I used the drawing that you saw.
You want to know where you got it from? Did the Navy give it to you? The picture?
No, that came right off the internet. The side view and the top view of that ship came off the internet. Just look up.
I think she meant when you way back then, before we had the internet, how did you create the drawing? By looking at the airplane and then drawing it, or a picture of it?
No, I can plot any place on that ship I want through descriptive geometry.
Where did you get the original plane here? Did you have a photograph of the carrier and then?
No, the airplane.
Using mathematics and other ways to make
the ship has not even been commissioned yet.
You took a course in analytic geometry and stuff like that.
No, it's basically I can take the drawings of anything, and by using descriptive geometry, I can find exactly how big they are at a certain distance. Actually, a description of how that works is you have a picture window. And it's just a glass window like that. And descriptive geometry, perspective projection by descriptive geometry, is the same as putting a grease pencil on the end of a stick and tracing what you see through that glass. But what you're seeing through that glass is a top view and a side view. And you're plotting azimuth and elevation of points in space. Yes, it works. But it also means that it's absolutely 3D when you finish with it, because everything is exactly right. And all those little people that you're going to see on the deck, they have to be in scale from one end to the other. So I have this 6-foot man standing on the bow of the ship and then going back into space. And this would be like a telephoto lens from this distance when you see the ship. But they all had to be the right size and doing the right things. I sat and watched video that you just go on the internet and look up carrier trials for the F-35. And there'll be a lot of videos of people, the camera will be on the deck next to all these people, and they all line up in a certain position outside of a line that's on the deck of a ship. And you're standing there, and they start the airplanes catapulted. And I count one, and two, and three, till he's out in the distance. Well, I can see what all those guys are doing in 4 seconds, 5 seconds. So this airplane is only 4.5 to 5 seconds from launch. And everybody's running around doing what they were in the video. So then there were some other videos taken from off to the side of the ship showing the airplane landing. So I knew about how high he was above and how far aft the deck he was. So you can see me plotting here is the end of the deck. And then you can see he's 25 feet above the deck at that point. and so many feet aft of the deck, figured out from the video I saw in London. But this, and he's also got the nose up, and so he was plotted that way. It's a, by analysis, and then of course that's what he looks like in the painting. And then all over the ship are things, airplanes. There's one parked on the aft end on the port side, like almost back where the airplane was landing. This guy was taxiing in to position for the catapult. This one was, there are three of these guys lined up in front of the bridge, and there's one on the port catapult getting ready to go out. And I paint with three colors. My entire palette was sitting in my pocket.
Like you did the fortresses under fire.
I did all of it. I've always, the reason this, for this, I came into art in a different way. I was working with a training publications unit between two semesters, between my freshman and sophomore years at A&M. And then I was told when I had to change my career from flying to painting that I was going to have to learn printing, and I was going to have to learn photography and typesetting and all the other aspects of being an artist. And so I was told, suggested by my art director, that if I was going to be an artist, never take a job that isn't going to have one of those aspects in it, just so that you can learn. So when I, later on, I ended up working for 16 months as a stripper and opaker in an offset lithography house, which is handling the negatives.
Sorry, did we hear you correctly?
Yes, sure. I was a stripper. Peggy thought I should go on What's My Line. But anyway, that's a lot about finding what I was doing. Is I was stripping negatives for the print process colors in printing. And I found if you could in printing use magenta, cyan, and yellow, plus white, and of course in printing it's black also. When I finally, I didn't go to school to learn how to paint. It was years, I didn't paint in color for 10 years after I got started, because everything was, all the trade ads were black and white. Then pretty soon we got two color ads, and you'd have a second color. It would be one of the process colors. Then I had all three process colors because we were doing a red plus a black or a yellow. So when I started, I thought, well, why can't I just use those three colors? And it made it simple. I always thought I would go directly to that color. It is a lot cheaper. And it's not confusing like trying to figure out what is burnt umber. So basically,
well, you better not be colorblind.
So basically I can mix any color I want with those three colors.
Yes.
And the interesting part of it is colors are subtractive. Pigments are subtractive and light is additive. You must be a science teacher.
No, printer.
Printer, okay.
Most of my career, yes.
So what happens is that you've been to a science museum and seen three colors where they overlap, it's white. Well, in pigments, what happens is if it's a red, it has absorbed all the blue and yellow light and leaves only the red. So it's reflecting the light that from the sun has got all three of those colors in it. But if you want to see red, you subtract the yellow and the blue. Well, that's what we're doing when you photograph for full color. You block, you go for the red plate, you go for the yellow plate, and the blue plate. So basically for red paint, it's absorbing all the blue and yellow light. For yellow, it's absorbing all the red and blue. So, well, if you put all three of those together, they make black because they are absorbing all the light.
So I don't need black, and it's, and black always kills a painting anyway. So I can have a warm black or a cool black. So you can deal with a warm gray. You know, warm gray, you can go to a cool gray by just having a little less red, a little less yellow, a little more blue. So it actually is keep it simple, stupid. Right? Because I wasn't smart enough to figure out all those colors. So we start painting. And that's, you can see the, I start in the sun and then work away from the sun. And just keep working away until I end up with something like that. Which gives me, now I've established my sun. So when I start to paint on the airplane, I know now I'm doing, oh, I had another, one of the things I dealt with was, we'll get back to the painting, but the curvature of the earth. Any, if you look at photographs of carriers, they always look like they're diving. And the reason is, the earth's curvature is dropping away. So here I would be working with the vanishing point in space on the on straight on out. On anything I draw, all my descriptive geometry goes to a vanishing point. But what happens is the earth drops away. So that's not the vanishing point for your painting. It's in space. And of course, the higher you get, the more that's happening. But this is only 130 feet where our eye level is. And that means that the horizon is only 14 miles away. So something else I had to consider is how far away is the horizon? Yes. Now there's some formulas. I've forgotten exactly the numbers. I think it's 3.25 times the square root of your height above the water. which works out, it works out to 13.7 miles or something like that. I couldn't find that number as I was putting this together. But now, we start in the sun, and then we start here. Actually, I started out there. So you'll see that changes a lot from what you see now. But you come in here, and then we work at, from the sun in. And then everything else is going to be reflecting the color around it, because an airplane is a mirror. Bottom is going to be affected by what's below it. And the upper parts are going to be reflecting it. Just everything is a mirror.
Why is it a mirror? It doesn't have its own...
If you're looking at a table right now, whatever you see in the middle of that table in front of you, is that same angle coming off, it's going to be coming off of this wall, right? So the same thing with an airplane. I look at the airplane, and it's not the color of the airplane, but what is the color that's going to be at that angle off in the distance. So that means to the water or to the sky.
Well, it's got to be highly polished.
No, even in not highly, if highly polished, of course, that'll be the aluminum airplanes, and they're a lot of fun to paint. But even when you get the camouflage colors, you're going to be reflecting the warm colors and the warm and the cool that we were talking about. So if there's a cool, you'll have warm in the sun and then it'll cool off the back. You'll see the warm color on the left. You look down here below the radar in here. And then you get up in there, that's warm. Then you come over here, you're reflecting the sky into it. See that? So see, you can see the warmth there and the cool over here. Same thing here. Everything is a play of warms and cools. So now this is, I've lightened that up underneath there as I start to realize that this color is going to be reflected in there. This one is all colors that will be out and so forth. And then we can uncover the painting now, and you can see what it really looks like. But here's all those people that we were talking about. And you'll see it looks a lot different than this projector is
he's showing us here. But again, that's the whole procedure that I go through on every painting. Just keep it simple, stupid. If I deviate from that, it doesn't work.
How many hours from beginning to end, roughly?
We're gonna do that, yeah. Let's, how many hours?
From beginning to end.
Yeah. This one was difficult. This one, because of that ship sneaking into the picture. Yeah. A couple of things about that, since we've got them up here. I had dates on those drawings too. Before Christmas, the first drawings that you saw.
There's one.
Now see, this is now the second go around. I'm starting in January, and so from then on, I had a date of mid-April with this because it had to be photographed and framed and all that. It was presented to the Navy by Pratt & Whitney and themselves at the Naval Aviation Symposium. Pensacola on May the 3rd or 4th or something like that. So anyway, and the drawing part, once I settled down and figured out where I was going to be, I probably got all that drawing done in about two weeks or so onto the canvas. And then the painting itself takes, I think that one took about 3 weeks of solid painting, I'd say. But anyway, you can see everything on there there's something important about it. Like this line right here, you have to be on this side of this line to launch that airplane. And this line right here, coming this way, is the one that everybody has to be on this side to launch this airplane. Back in 1982, I went down and spent a week with the T2 Buckeye. Navy at Beeville, Texas, and I went out to the Lexington with the skipper herding solo students out, and I spent a day on board that ship. But what I noticed when we catapulted off, I looked to my right, and there were two guys standing right below the upper part of their chest and the head showing. One of them had a stopwatch, the other one had a plunger of some kind. So when I saw the guy give that signal to go, and we're on that catapult, I looked to my right, which would be looking from here over to this, instead of from this guy, and I saw him do this plunger. He pushed his hands down and thought, man, we're gonna go. And it seemed like forever. You know, the monkey pushed the ball in the spoon and it falls. And then when you do go, it's not a bang, it's just like being in a slingshot. It accelerates like that. But there's the two guys. But I knew they had to be there. Right. But there's all the rest of them, and there's the parked airplane back there that you saw landing. Through here and so forth. Oh yes, they're different colored vests for each job too. That was another thing that's going to be, when you get a chance to look at this is not the original, this is an identical copy digitally on canvas, and it belongs to Pratt & Whitney. It just hasn't been delivered up to them yet. It goes to their corporate offices. So we can unveil this and you can come up and look at it. Probably both of us, one on each side.
Just turn the switch off.
Do you have to get things approved in different stages?
They trust me, and but I kept them informed of the slides.
Sure.
Do you ever run into a hard ass and then you just about something different?
Yeah, back in the advertising agency, Dennis.
There's nothing going in here.
So what happened? The first thing that happens is you go in and call on an agency art director, and he's got an account executive who's made some agreement with the ad manager of the corporation. And so the word will come out to do this, and it'll come around and finally get to me. And but now I'm dealing with the low guy on the totem pole and all of that. And that being an art director, they're supposed to do something. So they want to change things. And most of them have no knowledge of what I do. They don't know the aviation. For example, I had one art studio who had dealt with an art buyer in an agency who was dealing with an art director and so forth down the line. I got this job and I said, I'm not going to do this. It's a Pratt & Whitney ad and you got an airplane powered by General Electric. That sort of thing. My favorite story, shall I tell that one about?
Yeah.
Can you turn the mic on again, please?
I am plugged. I didn't want anybody to trip on the mic.
Yeah. Roy Early. Does anybody remember that name?
Who?
Roy Early.
There you go.
Is it working now?
Yes.
Roy Early was the president CEO of Curtis Wright, which we always called Curtis Rowan. And they had an accounting firm. They had an advertising manager named. Remember what his name was? But anyway, and he dealt with an advertising agency in Upper Montclair, which I was dealing with. And so I was called into the agency by the art director, and he said that you have to exactly match these colors. There's a little triangle sliver of paper. But what had happened is Roy Hurley had called in his head manager and said, I want it done with these colors. And he had a tractor catalog, the John Deere catalog, and he had the wheel and the hubcap around it. And he took that and he cut it in half. And he gave the half to the head manager. The head manager cut his half and made it a quarter and gave it to the art director. Art director cut it half, but I got it. Well, actually, it's reverse. It went to the account executive, then the art director. By the time I got it, it was a little sliver of that color that I had to match with the guy. That's typical stuff. But it gradually turned out that advertising agencies, I would be correct, the advertising agencies would be wrong. Then the clients would know that I was the one who was right. So it didn't take too long for them to come directly to me and bypass all of those.
Well, it meant everybody love you, right?
Right. Well, my whole approach when we came to New Jersey, which was 1956, I got a hold of Aviation Week and Space Technology and Muscles and Rickets, which was missiles and rockets. We called it Muscles and Rickets. They all had advertising agencies for all the ads. And you see the ads and then you see who the agency was and so forth. So I would look through there and I would see, obviously the people who were doing the art had no idea about aviation. So I would call on those art directors that had the biggest trouble finding somebody that knew anything about aviation. Then my job became keeping those art directors out of trouble. Because I could speak Air Force and understood the aviation that most artists could. So it worked out pretty well. So, yes.
Keith, I asked you this question last time, but I think much of the audience would like to hear the answer. Why wouldn't a photograph work as well as this? What advantage does the art, your artwork give?
The one advantage I have is I can be there and the camera can't. So that's the first thing. The other thing is that the eye sees a lot better than the camera. The camera sees everything equally. But when you're looking at me right now, he's not in focus. You see? So all around, this depends on what you're looking at. So I can control how much, I can control how much detail there is in this versus what's there. And I can control the warms and the cools and get all the contrast, which the camera's gonna see it all. And
all at once.
All at once, and that's not the way you see. So I can direct every source the way you're gonna be seeing it. I have an astronaut friend that I flew with back in the weapons school at Dallas, who's turning into an artist. And he spent from April to September in space in the ISS and has a million photographs. And of course he's trying to be an artist, he's got all those photographs to copy. And I'm trying to explain to him what, I'm talking spatial relationships to a guy who's been in space. it's highly amusing. But he understands that what he saw and what he sees in his photography is not what he actually was seeing with his own eyes. Because of these things we're talking about. So the camera, so art can outperform the camera. And of course, back in the 50s, there were so few photographs of new airplanes. So that if an F-105 rolls out for the first time, every ad in every magazine has the same photographs in it. I didn't need any photographs. I could do any view I wanted. And especially did things that where you couldn't get a camera. So.
So you couldn't take a selfie?
No. Oh, I've done that. anyway, well, let's take this off.
But again, just as he said, the characters seem to be special visually now. It's just because
All right, get a shot with him and the painting, a couple of angles.
Get tight on it, Allison. Oh, the sun's coming out.
Right.
like a better America, or greater America, whatever that is.
Look at that.
You know what? That looks realistic. So this is a digital print of us. Did you just take a picture of us?
Everybody look this way just for a second, okay? We'll get you all good, okay? Get a bunch of pictures here, okay? Excellent. Now Peggy has to get the picture too.
Come on.
It looks different.
That's what you get.
The water really came alive now with the sun.
Look at the camera if you can.
Yeah, look at the camera here, okay? Okay.
You may be in the Air Force magazine.
That's right, Air Force magazine.
We should be on the cover if you ask.
They're actually the cover, right, okay.
Centerfold.
Centerfold.
Oh, that's a good shot.
Thank you. Okay, that's great. Okay.
We'll take four.
I know.
Oh, it's lovely. It's beautiful.
I'm going to pull my Jag up here, put the top down.
Put this
and we'll shoot this in the background. I think that'd be a
Oh, yeah.
We're going to help you get to the car.
Oh, absolutely.
We can get to the car.
Yeah, we're